We're all familiar with the history in the U.S. Of white colonizers, European colonizers, framing African slaves as well as American Indians as savages. In fact, there's this famous quote from Mark Twain in which he says, "There are many humorous things in this world, among them the white man's notion that he is less savage than the other savages." So when I read a quote like that, which I think is brilliant, and I think Mark Twain was quite brilliant and pretty radical politically, what I think about is what was the function? What is the function of what Twain is talking about there? Twain was actually talking about U.S. imperialist intervention in the Sandwich Islands, which we now call Hawaii, where people from the U.S., white colonizers, went into Hawaii, colonized the Sandwich Islands, and justified this by calling the people of those islands savages. So we are going in there, murdering them, killing them, colonizing against no military force these islands, and justifying it by calling them savages. In the same way slavery was justified, right? Taming the wild beast, or the annihilation of Native American communities was justified. So the question is, what was the function? What is the function of framing, whether it's African slaves or American Indians or any other group, as savages? We know racism is a root of that, but what was the practical function of that? Today we have this notion, deficit ideology, to describe what I would argue is actually the function of that, which is to socialize people to comply with these horrible oppressions and to justify the oppressions by framing those who are being oppressed as the problem, and those who are the oppressors as the solver of the problem. So I want to talk a little bit about this notion, deficit ideology, how it plays out in society today and in schools today, and how can we spot it? Because one of the ways that I think even those of us who are committed to equity and social justice, one of the ways I think we often slip into ways of talking about these issues that contribute to the very inequities we would like to destroy is by participating in this deficit ideology. So let me start with this. Many of us are familiar with the notion of the deficit perspective. The deficit perspective, of course, is when, for instance, a teacher approaches a group of students based on assumptions about those students' weaknesses rather than the assumptions about the students' strengths. And so we've developed like this whole sort of vocabulary around challenging the deficit perspective in education. You know, all students are gifted and talented. All students can learn. That sort of thing, which is pushing back against the deficit perspective. But like every perspective, the deficit perspective has an underlying ideology that puts more of a sort of social context around that perspective. And for the deficit perspective, that bigger context is deficit ideology. Deficit ideology is, in essence, is kind of a worldview that explains outcome inequalities, like, for instance, the quote-unquote achievement gap in schools, as resulting from supposed moral, intellectual, or cultural deficiencies within disenfranchised communities and individuals, right? So we talk about the achievement gap and the sort of schoolhouse chatter that happens around the achievement gap, where, who's blamed for the achievement gap, right? So the notion that the achievement gap is largely the result of parents who just don't care about their kids' education. That would be a classic example of deficit ideology, and I'll talk about why in just a second. Think about a bigger issue. Think about poverty as even a bigger issue, and the notion that poor people are poor because they are lazy, right? Again, that would be an example of deficit ideology. It takes some kind of inequality and explains it based on perceived or assumed deficiencies within the group at the bottom of a hierarchy. Another example would be, for instance, the glass ceiling, and people making the argument that, well, women just aren't very good leaders. Another classic example of deficit ideology. Another sort of example of deficit ideology, another way to think about it, would be that deficit ideology is kind of a worldview that where these bigger social conditions are completely ignored and dismissed, right? So we don't think about, for instance, the issue of poverty. We don't think about poverty. If we're going to make the argument that poverty is due to the laziness of poor people, then the question is, what are the different social dimensions that we have to ignore in order to make that argument? For instance, we have to ignore the lack of living wage work in the U.S. In fact, we even would have to ignore something like the unequal access to education, that low-income people are sent disproportionately to schools that are less funded, where they have less experienced teachers, where they have where they're under-resourced and those sorts of things. Take, for instance, another example, the racial achievement gap. If we argue that the achievement gap exists because some parents, say families of color, just don't care very much about education, we have to ignore all kinds of social conditions, again, about what kinds of schools different people are sent to. Lifetimes of racism we have to ignore in order to buy into deficit ideology. I would argue, my just being around these conversations about education, I would argue that deficit ideology drives a lot of these conversations in education today, even among people who are pretty well-intentioned and pretty committed to equity or diversity or multiculturalism or even social justice. So the question is, why? Why do people buy into this? I think one of the reasons that people buy into it is that deficit ideology draws on the stereotypes that already are embedded in the mainstream psyche. So for instance, the stereotype that poor people are lazy or that poor people don't care about education. The fact is that in the U.S., people, for the most part, already believe in those stereotypes, which, in fact, is a fairly, in the long sort of scheme of things, is a fairly new phenomenon. If you go before the mid-1970s in the U.S., polls about why people thought poor people were poor revealed that most people thought that poor people were poor because of a lack of opportunity and a lack of access. But after the mid-1970s, which a lot of people sort of define as sort of the birth of the neoliberal movement, since then and through today, most people in the U.S. actually believe that poor people are poor because of their own deficiencies. And so we have a whole sort of education dialogue that happens around that. And of course, I think Ruby Payne is part of that dialogue. People believe the stereotypes in her work because, you know, they already come into her work believing that poor people are lazy, that poor people have bad language skills, that poor people are violent. Of course, you know, having done the research about all this, what's interesting is that all these stereotypes are actually false stereotypes. There is no evidence that poor people on average are lazier than wealthy people, or even that they don't care about education as much as wealthier people. So when you draw on these stereotypes that already exist, that people already bring into the conversation, it can be really easy to engage people in this kind of deficit ideology. But it also works because we, as individuals, are conditioned to stereotype in the worst ways people who fall outside of our identity groups. And so there's this whole kind of psychosocial research that talks about this, how we tend to see our own groups as being very diverse, right? So you might hear somebody say, well, don't lump me in with all those other white people, you know, that kind of thing. On the other hand, we see people outside of our identity groups as being more monolithic. And that's why you'd have a situation like somebody who would never look at Timothy McVeigh blowing up a building and all of a sudden think that all conservative Christian white men are terrorists, and all of a sudden, and when Timothy McVeigh blew up that building, you didn't all of a sudden have white Christian men being pulled out of cars and beaten up because they were white Christian men, right? And that's because white people saw Timothy McVeigh as not like them, right? But then, 9/11 happens or other events like that happen, and all of a sudden, all people, they don't even have to be Arab or Muslim. They just have to look like they might be. And all of a sudden, people are responding in that way. And also, the research shows that we are conditioned to stereotype target groups, even when we're part of that target group. And that's what people talk about internalized oppression. So in other words, we're socialized to through the media, through our religious organizations, our families, our peer groups, and that sort of thing, to stereotype groups who are already at the bottom of the social hierarchy. And talk more about that in just a second. The other question to go back to here is, well, then what is the function of deficit ideology? If this is the way we're going to talk about poor people in education, and I'm going to give you an example of how this works in just a second, of poor people, of students of color, what are the functions of that? What purpose does it serve? Whose interests does it protect? One of the functions of deficit ideology is to morally justify existing social conditions. And it does this by locating the problem of outcome inequalities as existing within disenfranchised communities, as opposed to being leveled against disenfranchised communities, right? So this is where we hear this chatter like, well, if those people just cared more about their children's education, if those people just weren't so lazy, if those people would, stop drinking and doing drugs. And that last one, by the way, is really interesting because, for instance, white people are more likely to be substance abusers than people of color, and wealthy people are more likely to be substance abusers than poor people. So again, the stereotypes don't even have to be accurate if people are socialized to believe that they're accurate. But this is a way that these social conditions can be justified. Look at all the deficiencies in those communities. And that's why these inequalities exist. But the other function of deficit ideology is to divert our attention away from systemic conditions that exist. So if I am talking about the economic achievement gap only in terms of poor people's supposed deficiencies, then the question is, what am I not talking about? I'm not talking about unequal educational funding that disproportionately privileges wealthier people in the U.S. I'm not talking about increasing resegregation racially of public schools in the U.S. that has benefited white students because those students tend to end up on average in the better resourced schools than students of color, right? So rather than talking about economic injustice, rather than talking about racism, rather than talking about sexism, deficit ideology has us talking about how to fix disenfranchised people, right? So it's not about how to fix the inequitable school funding, but how to fix the people who are the worst affected by inequitable school funding. I refer to this as a scornful gaze. So if you take any sort of social or political hierarchy and you have, so if this is the wealth hierarchy here, you have the wealthy people at the top and you have the poorest people at the bottom. And this function of deficit ideology is to focus our attention down that pyramid, down that hierarchy, so that we're identifying the problems at the bottom of the hierarchy rather than at the top of the hierarchy. And more about that in just a second. The result of all of this, and how you can see this playing out in educational policy, is that deficit ideology helps to ensure that the solutions that we popularly come up with to fix these outcome inequalities, like the achievement gap, focus on fixing disenfranchised communities rather than fixing those things that disenfranchise communities, right? So let's stick with the issue of class and poverty for just a second. If we look at some of the most popular ways in which schools are putting resources into addressing the economic achievement gap, you have things like tutoring programs for low-income students, mentoring programs for low-income students, parenting workshops. I mean, the one that I, as a product of a family from poor Appalachia, find the most offensive are all of these workshops on parenting for poor, low-income parents. So the assumption is that the problem that exists in the poor community. They don't have good parents. They don't have good role models. They don't have good mentors. And all of the resources going into these sorts of programs that assume that the problem exists within the poor community. Now, let me be very clear about this. I, of course, believe that anybody who needs access to a tutor or access to a mentor, regardless of their economic status or their gender or sexual orientation or race or whatever, ought to have access to those things, of course. I'm sure we all believe that. But identifying the problem of the economic achievement gap or the racial achievement gap or any other form of the achievement gap, identifying that problem solely based on what poor communities lack without addressing those bigger those savage inequalities that Jonathan Kozol has talked about, that is classic deficit ideology. Let me just run you through sort of a quick snapshot of an example of how this works. So classic deficit ideology. You start with any kind of myth or stereotype. So low-income families do not value education. That is a stereotype. You can find it in Ruby Payne's work. You can find it sort of rolling easily off the tongues of people all over the education spectrum. The problem is low-income families don't value education. And then we use that myth or that stereotype to justify an outcome inequality. So, for instance, because low-income families don't value education, poor students don't do as well in school as their wealthier peers, right? It's the parents' fault. Or if only low-income families cared more about education, this achievement gap wouldn't exist, right? So classic deficit ideology, you define the problem as solely as existing within the low-income community or the disenfranchised community. Now, the other thing that we have to do for most of these stereotypes is ignore the fact that this is completely false. We have research going back to the mid-1970s, right through today, that show that poor families, low-income families, have the exact same attitudes about the value of education as wealthier families. Exact same attitudes, which is quite remarkable when you consider that low-income families don't have the same access to education as wealthy families do. So despite the fact that they are denied the same access, they still value education in the exact same way. So the next step in this is train the gaze downward, that scornful gaze down, remember that hierarchy, down the hierarchy, right? By ignoring the larger social context, those larger inequities, right? So this is the point where we just conveniently forget about things like funding disparities, these choice programs that people talked about as if they were about equality, which research has shown have actually given the people who already had the most access, additional access, rather than the people who didn't have the same kind of access. And of course, even curricular and pedagogical disparities, where you go into wealthier schools and see students being engaged with much higher level curriculum and pedagogies than you see at lower income schools on average. Or even taking a step back, the scarcity of living wage work, the lack of access to healthcare. I mean, in this sense, we can start talking about the achievement gap. What actually, I would argue, is an opportunity gap, not an achievement gap. That achievement gap framing in and of itself, I would say, is deficit ideology. But we could start that conversation, if we wanted to be completely accurate about this, we could start that conversation at prenatal care and who has access to prenatal care. But the deficit ideology view ignores all of that, ignores all of that context. So the next step is, so we develop solutions through the lens of this ideology. So we develop solutions to, say, the economic achievement gap or opportunity gap through these deficit lenses, right? So this is where, again, we have the parenting workshops for low-income families, mentoring programs, tutoring programs, and that sort of thing. Classic example of how this plays out is the popularity of that culture of poverty myth, where the whole idea of why the achievement gap exists is blamed on the culture of poverty. And by the way, the culture of poverty, we have studies from the starting in the early 1970s that show that there actually is no such thing as a culture of poverty. An interesting little factoid, by the way. The term blaming the victim was actually coined in the early 1970s by a social scientist named William Ryan. William Ryan was wrote a book responding to the culture of poverty mythology and how it contributes to a deficit view. And in his response to the culture of poverty, he coined the term blaming the victim. So that whole term was coined in response to the culture of poverty model. And then the next step to this, of course, is that we never address the underlying injustice that exists, right? So as a result, what we've done is we've taken a problem, the economic achievement gap, or what I would call the economic opportunity gap, and we try to fix it by fixing supposed deficiencies in the poor community without ever fixing the ways in which the poor community is denied access and opportunity that wealthier communities take advantage. So there's no redistribution of resources here. There's no redistribution of opportunity. All it is about fixing that low-income community. Now, there are a couple of ways in which we as teachers or whatever role you play in society, that we, I believe, are socialized to buy into deficit ideology. I think there's a couple of layers of this. One of the layers is are sort of these big myths about the U.S. So this would be like meritocracy. Meritocracy is the notion that what people achieve, they achieve through merit. What people accumulate, they accumulate through merit. So that the idea is that anything you want, if you work hard enough, you can get it. If you merit it, you will get it. And that, of course, is one of the big myths of the U.S. And actually, education is used as a pawn in that myth, because the education system is often framed in the U.S. as the great equalizer, despite the fact that the wealthiest students go to the best schools and the lowest income students are sent to the most under-resourced schools. And so in that sense, and of course, many people have written about this, in that sense, schools seem to basically replicate the inequities that exist in the larger society. So those kind of big myths, those rags to riches type stories, those kinds of things that we all grew up with. Another sort of layer of this are the kind of social construction of identity myths, right? So again, this goes to all those stereotypes. So poor people, for example, as violent, lazy, substance addicted, and those sorts of things. So those kind of stereotypes. And so that's why it can be very easy, even for sort of the most well-intentioned of us, to buy into these stereotypes and then buy into deficit ideology. And that's why I would argue even people who are really committed to educational equity, to social justice, are kind of trapped or stuck in this achievement gap conversation and this achievement gap discourse that frames the whole conversation and in a way that I would argue reflects deficit ideology. So now the question is, how do I spot deficit ideology? How do I spot it in my own mind? How do I spot it when I hear colleagues buying into it and those sorts of things. So here's what I would suggest you look for. One is to look for stereotypes and myths. If you want a great example of this, you can look at, for instance, Ruby Payne's work, and look at all the stereotypes, the false stereotypes that are just all through her work. They're very prevalent in her work. Poor people as lazy, poor people as violent, poor people as addicts, even though there is no evidence that poor people have any more of a propensity for violence, are any more likely to be substance abusers, are any more likely to be lazy than wealthy people. So that's one thing to look for. Another thing to look for is the practice of locating the problem within the most disenfranchised communities. Right. So if we're talking about the racial achievement gap and the whole conversation centered around what we have to fix about people of color, that is a clear sign that it's deficit ideology. And then also the lack of acknowledgement of systemic conditions. So I'm going to sort of close this with a story that I think illustrates this really well. This is a true story from about 6 or 7 years ago when I lived in Minnesota. I got a phone call from an aide of one of the local legislators, and the aide was pitching this program and asking for my support. And the program is basically this. This legislator wanted to pass a bill that would require all young women, eighth grade students, to take self-defense classes as part of their experience in eighth grade, that this would be required for all eighth grade young women. When I asked why they wanted to do this, the aide explained to me that this was in response to the growing problem of sexual assault and sexual harassment in schools. So think for just a second about why would that be an example of deficit ideology? As you're thinking about that, let me share with you how I responded to that. I said, well, I think it's an interesting idea. And I said, I will get behind this on one condition. You'll have my full support. I'll put the support of my organization, EdChange, behind it under one condition. And the condition is, while for every minute that those eighth grade young women are spending in those self-defense classes, I want the young men in anti-sexism training. So while the young women are in self-defense classes, the young men ought to be in anti-sexism training. To me, the problem with the initial proposal was that it assumed that the reason sexual assault was a growing problem was because young women didn't know how to defend themselves from sexual assault. And you could see the classic response is, okay, so if that's my mindset, what is my policy response? If my mindset is that women can't defend themselves and that's why sexual assault is a problem, the policy response is to fix that disenfranchised community. Well, we'll teach women how to defend themselves. But what are we ignoring? We're ignoring the bigger social context of that problem, which is sexism, which is patriarchy, which is male privilege, and those sorts of things, right? So the other thing to look for is, are those bigger contexts being addressed? Now, I might feel, if I'm an individual teacher, that those bigger contextual things are not part of my purview, are not part of my sphere of influence. But if I don't at the very least, understand my work in the context of that larger social context, then it would be very easy for me to fall into that deficit ideology. And like always, I want to clarify that this is not about bad intentions. This is not about purposefully racist teachers doing purposely racist things. This is about us. This is about how we're socialized. It's about how I'm socialized. It's about the most well-intentioned of us, being susceptible to the ways in which we're socialized. So how do we look for the ways in which our own socialization might open us up to fall into this kind of deficit ideology? So once again, thank you for listening. If you have any questions, of course, as always, you can email me at Gorski, G-O-R-S-K-I, at edchange.org.